So it's great to see you all here as usual, and also as usual, if you ever want to go back there while I'm talking and grab a brownie or something, I won't mind. It won't be distracting, so please feel free to do that. It certainly wouldn't bother me at all. Do we have enough chairs? Looks like some people might be standing. If there's any other chairs back there, maybe we could bring them out. But before I begin with the first installment in our series of lectures on the wars involving U.S. forces and Native Americans during the 18th and 19th centuries, I just thought I'd maybe say a couple words about terminology. Normally, when I give lectures like this, I would be referring to the Indian nations by their names. For example, next week I'll be talking about the Seminoles, Seminoles this, Seminoles that. But today, and maybe also when I talk about the Battle of Little Bighorn, we're dealing with a number of different indigenous peoples. So rather than go through the list of the actual names of the nations, I may just refer to them collectively as Indians. I hope that won't be offensive, but I thought that might be a more convenient term. And as far as United States forces, I usually wouldn't say United States forces consisting, as they did, people of European and African ancestry. Sometimes I'll say American forces or U.S. forces, but you'll know what I mean. Forces in the employ of the U.S. government. So with that terminology maybe out of the way, let me begin with our very first installment in this series of lectures that has to do with the Ohio Wars of 1790 to 1794. It's a topic, unfortunately, little understood or little appreciated, but it was certainly one of the most important sequences in the long story of indigenous resistance to U.S. forces, and I thought it would be a good place to begin, in part because it was the very first war against indigenous peoples waged by the United States. Our story begins just a few miles from here, at the Bunch of Grapes Tavern on March 1st, 1786, in the town of Boston, in what is now State Street, but they used to call it King Street. So, now we go back to the other one. Yeah, so the Bunch of Grapes, I think, is sort of in here on King Street, now State Street, in the shadow of the old State House. And there, on that March afternoon in 1786, a group of New England investors met to form what they call the Ohio Company of Associates, or as it's usually called, the Ohio Company. They were led by a Revolutionary War veteran, very famous back then, named Rufus Putnam. You can always go to Rutland, Massachusetts in Worcester County, and you can stay at his house because it's now a bed and breakfast. At this point, in 1786, he was in his 40s, and he was interested in making a little bit of money, because the plan of the Ohio Company was to purchase wide tracts of land from the brand new U.S. Independent Congress. We're not with the Constitution yet, it's still 1786, but there was a Congress under the Articles of Confederation, and that Congress owed increasing amounts of Western land that had been deeded to Congress by the various states after the Revolution. So if you can go to the next slide, we can see a little bit more of what I'm talking about. And the Ohio Company believed that if they could just put together a great deal of money and buy a lot of that Western land, especially here in what was called the Ohio Country, right in there to the west of the U.S. state of Pennsylvania, then they would have no trouble selling it to settlers who were interested in moving out there, especially from New England, because here it is the 1780s, and the land in New England was increasingly becoming exhausted, Massachusetts, New Hampshire, and in Connecticut especially, and there were plenty of young men and women who wanted a chance to move out to better land and maybe make a better life for themselves away from land which is not nearly as productive as it used to be in the homes where they grew up. So the idea was to buy a lot of that land, sell it to settlers, and make a profit along the way. So Putnam and his friends, having formed the company on King Street, went to Congress, and they managed to purchase 1.5 million acres of land in what is now southeastern Ohio at a cost of $1 million in United States bonds, working out to a price of about 12 cents an acre. Not a bad deal, pretty much a bargain price, but Congress in 1786 was happy to get any money they could, and so they made the deal. All they required in Congress was that the land not just be a matter of speculation. The idea was they shouldn't be selling it to people who would just hang on to it and then sell it to others over the course of the years. Congress wanted that land settled, so the idea was that the Ohio Company would buy the land, $1.5 million, and parcel it out and sell it to people who are actually willing to farm it. to that end, and also they were supposed to build schools. So Ohio was supposed to look like a little New England with a little common school in every community. That was one of the conditions under which Congress sold the land in the first place, and the Ohio Company agreed. So to that end, 2 years later, 1788, Rufus Putnam himself gathered together 48 men and led them, not women yet, they're soon to come, 48 men, and led them down to the Ohio to the point where the Muskingum River comes into the Ohio, right here at a place that he called Marietta. That'd be the first town in the territory of Ohio settled by people of European and African ancestry. So it's the Muskingum River and the confluence with the Ohio. And this is a good place to pause and ask, where did they get the name Marietta? I've always kind of wondered that. So one of the nice things about this lecture was I got to go find out. Anybody know where Marietta came from? Anybody? It's named after Queen Marie Antoinette. So this is just right before the beginning of the French Revolution. And King Louis XVI was a great hero in America because the French had helped us during the Revolution. And Marie Antoinette was a likely name for the first town here in the Ohio Company's settlements. Those of you who are especially curious about this, you may be interested to know, but you probably won't be, that Marietta, Georgia is not named after Marie Antoinette. It's named after Mary Cobb, wife of an early Georgia settler. So go ahead, yes.
Quick question. Has this land been surveyed?
It had been surveyed. They surveyed it right after buying it. They did that in 1787, and the people arrived in 1788. So yeah, it had been surveyed. So all you needed to do, if you wanted to own the land outright, was to show up, preferably eventually with a family, and the Ohio Company would sell you a certain parcel. And in order to get title outright, what you had to do was actually improve the land. So what you'd have to show was some sort of dwelling, some sort of house, and the house would have to have a cellar and a chimney. So it can't just be a shack that you put up to get title. There had to be a cellar, there had to be a chimney. You had to plant at least 20 acres of cultivated land. And one way that you could pass that requirement was to have at least 50 apple trees on the land. So if you planted an orchard, that was improving the land. That showed you meant business, and that way you could get title to it. And because you had to plant 50 apple trees, that was one way to do it. That gave the famous John Chapman, Johnny Appleseed, a really good idea for a business model. Why not proceed through Ohio and eventually points west a little bit later and plant apple trees wherever you went? And that way that you would have your own partial title to the land, at least, and then you could sell it at a profit to anybody who came later because you'd already done the hard work of planting the apple trees. And so that's how Johnny Appleseed became a household word. And those apples were not very good to eat, but they were very good for making apple cider, which is what most people would do with them. A very sharp taste, unpleasant to the palate, but very nice in cider. And a lot of those trees, unfortunately, are gone now. Prohibition agents got rid of a lot of them after 1920. But you can still see one apple tree planted by Johnny Appleseed, and it's in Savannah, Ohio, near the banks of Lake Erie. And the Morgan family live there. If you show up at their house, they'd be more than happy to show you the tree. And as far as we know, that's the last of the trees planted by Johnny Appleseed. Now, all of this is really good news for the investors in the Ohio Company. They know they're going to be able to sell this land. They're very happy about it. But of course, this is decidedly bad news to the Indians of the Ohio country who had been living there, in many cases, for many generations. So these included the Pottawatomies, the Sauks, the Fox Indians, the Kickapoos, the Wyandots. There were Delawares living in the Ohio country. But most numerous were the Shawnees and the Miamis. And they all had a lot in common with one another, including the fact that they tended to speak an Algonquian dialect, not much different from what New England Indians actually spoke, and a dialect that was worlds away from the language the Iroquois spoke in upstate New York. It's like comparing English and Chinese. But the Shawnees, the Miamis, largely related also among the other Indian groups who were in the Ohio country, and that made it natural for them to form a confederation that was determined to resist further U.S. settlement in the Ohio country. The Shawnees, in fact, were the southernmost Algonquian speakers in North America, as far as we know. We think their name, Shawnee, means southern breeze or people of the southern wind, because they lived, many of them, actually south of the Ohio River as well as north of it. The Miamis, we think, were originally from the lands west of Lake Michigan, and they had moved in to the Ohio country in the 17th century under pressure from the Iroquois, who were to the north in Canada by then, many of them, and were pressuring them north into Wisconsin and into Michigan, which would force them into the Ohio country. By the way, Miami, in this context, the Miami Indians of the Old Northwest have nothing to do with the word Miami in Florida. They're totally different words, totally different sources, as people in Ohio, if you meet them, will be very happy to tell you. Completely different. Now, as of the 1780s, the Iroquois people of upstate New York and parts of Canada were rapidly dwindling in power, leaving the Indians of the Ohio country free and uninterrupted control of those lands. And they had plentiful weapons happily supplied to them from the British in Canada, and not just the British in Canada, but also the British who were still occupying U.S. territory, despite what they had agreed to do at the Treaty of Paris in 1783. So as of the time we're talking about, there were still British garrisons in Detroit, and also here at Fort Miami, at the mouth of the Maumee River, where it goes into Lake Erie. That's where Toledo is now, but that's where Fort Miami, a British outpost, was back then. So armed with British support, literally with British weapons, the Indian Confederacy of the Ohio country would be a formidable enemy indeed. Now, by that time, the Miamis, the Shawnees, and their allies, they tended to live in small towns where, if you happened to go to them, they wouldn't look that much different from anything you'd see in Pennsylvania or indeed in upstate New York. They lived a life based upon settled agriculture, supplemented by trade and hunting, as they long had lived. And their most important town, at least among the Miamis, was over here, right about there, which they call Kikionga. Kikionga is at the forks of the Maumee, where the St. Joseph's and the St. Mary's meet to form the Maumee River about there. And you can see that it's a pretty strategically important place, because there's the Maumee from Lake Erie. This is the Wabash River connecting to the Ohio. So if you wanted to go from the Great Lakes to the Ohio, you'd have to portage between the Maumee and the Wabash. And the Kikionga was right there at the height of that portage area, which is why it was a pretty important town. If you went there, you would see very well-built houses, many of them wooden frame, just as you would see in any frontier community, whether inhabited by people of European and African ancestry or indigenous peoples. The leader, one of the leaders of the Miamis living in Kikionga, was a guy named Misikanakwa, and we can go two slides away from this to see him, better known to the Americans as Little Turtle. So there's Little Turtle there, the leader, or one of the leaders of the Miamis. And by the time Putnam showed up on the Ohio, building the small town of Marietta, Little Turtle, as you can see here, was 40 years old and at the height of his considerable abilities. He was, in fact, although nobody knew it, among the U.S. forces, a military genius of the First Order, as we're about to see. He also had the nicest house in Kikionga. And in his backyard, there was actually a privy that would seat five people. Very convenient, I suppose, if you had guessed. Now, the Miami's Shawnee allies lived mostly to the southeast of Kikionga, close to the banks of the Scioto River and part of central Ohio. And they happened to have a warrior leader fully as talented and fully as impressive as Little Turtle. And his name was Weapinisua, usually known as Blue Jacket. We don't have a picture of Blue Jacket that I think is any good. But Blue Jacket was certainly a Shawnee. The reason I say certainly was because for many years, beginning with an article in 1877, there was this myth that Blue Jacket, one of the Shawnee leaders, was actually a white man named Marmaduke von Swearingen. I think some people figured that somebody as smart as Blue Jacket couldn't possibly not be white. So they had this idea that he was a white trader named Marmaduke von Swearingen. Now, that was a curious idea, especially given that during Blue Jacket's life, nobody ever seems to have come up with this idea that it was anything but Shawnee. But for 100 years after this article, it was taught in schools that he was actually a white man named Marmaduke von Swearingen. We know now that that's not true because of DNA testing. We know now that Blue Jacket was indeed Shawnee. But he remains today a hero among the Shawnee. But to most people, if you know his name at all, you know it as the mascot of the Columbus franchise in the NHL, the Blue Jackets. The Blue Jackets are named after Blue Jacket, the great leader of the Shawnee. Now, neither Little Turtle nor Blue Jacket had any intention of surrendering their lands without a fight. And within a year of Marietta settlement, by 1789, the Shawnees, the Pottawatomies, the Foxes, the Sox, the Miamis, they were conducting raids on outlying settlements that the Ohio Company was sponsoring in the Ohio Valley. And so the settlers there and also the Ohio Company of Associates, still based in Boston, petitioned the young United States government, now in Philadelphia with George Washington as president, for help in fending off these Indian raids. And what they wanted was for the army to be sent into the Ohio country to drive off the Shawnees and Miamis and solidify United States' hold on that territory. There's only one problem. As of 1784, 4 years before Putnam arrived in Marietta with those 48 settlers, the entire United States Army consisted of 80 men, 55 of them doing nothing in particular at West Point, and 25 keeping an anxious watch on doings to the west at Fort Pitt, now Pittsburgh. Their highest ranking officer was a captain in the middle of the 1780s, and things had not improved, as you might say if you actually spoke English, improved. Things had not improved as much, very much, as of the end of the 1780s. By then, the U.S. Army consisted of about 700 men by 1789, lured by the promise of $7 a month in pay. Most of them were stationed still in Pennsylvania at Fort Pitt, in a little bit south of Fort Pitt, under the command of a Revolutionary War veteran named Joseph Harmar, H-A-R-M-A-R. So Joseph Harmar, in 1789, when our story really begins, was living a perfectly nice life in command of hundreds of men in the brand new U.S. Army. He was living along with many of his men at a place called Fort McIntosh, just across the Ohio border, still in Pennsylvania, where he enjoyed rich dinners of perch and catfish, supplemented in season by strawberries. He really liked strawberries, and he ate all the strawberries he could. He also very much liked whiskey and rum and Madeira wine, which he imported in bulk from Philadelphia. And when he felt up to it, Harmar would drill his men in the tactics first introduced to the United States by Baron von Steuben in 1777, when he arrived at Valley Forge. Now, Steuben was a perfectly fine drill master, and there was nothing wrong with these tactics that Steuben introduced to the young Continental Army in Valley Forge. And if Harmar was about to go into battle with British forces on the plains of New Jersey, these tactics would have been perfectly fine. There would have been nothing wrong. Harmar seems never to have considered the idea that maybe Little Turtle in Blue Jacket would have been following tactics a little bit different from Baron von Steuben, pioneered in Prussia many thousands of miles away. And so Harmar would drill these men in Steuben tactics, which in the end would prove next to useless. The only good thing that came out of this obsession with Baron von Steuben was that when Harmar got to Ohio, he saw fit to name one of the early settlements Steubenville, after Baron von Steuben. And you could go to Steubenville, Ohio, anytime you want, see Steubenville pottery, see a bunch of murals in Steubenville, all because of this drill master that Harmar respected so much, almost to the point of hero worship. At any rate, in 1789, Washington ordered Harmar to take several hundred men, members of this brand new U.S. Army, down the Ohio River to do something about the Indian raids that the settlers in the Ohio Company had been complaining about. Now, Washington knew that Harmar had a drinking problem, but he agreed to keep him in command because Secretary of War Henry Knox had urged that he be kept in command. Maybe Washington should not have listened to Knox. By this point, in the early days of the Washington administration, Henry Knox was spending way too much time speculating in lands up in Maine than in military matters. But although hardly anybody gave any thought to what this project was actually going to be like, Harmar was indeed put in command. And without even considering the fact that Little Turtle and Blue Jacket could muster many thousands of warriors to oppose them, Harmar was content to go into battle with a few hundred regulars and however many militia he could muster from Pennsylvania and Kentucky. All of them would be inexperienced. All of them would be armed by leftover muskets from the Revolution, many of which weren't much good anymore. Rifles would have been better. If they had good Kentucky rifles, that would have been good, but the army had less than 100 of them, so that wasn't going to make much of a difference. Nevertheless, Harmar seemed perfectly confident as he arrived in Marietta and led his force down the Ohio. Now we can go to the preceding slide, not the next one, but the one before. And this is the fort he built a little bit further down the Ohio. This is Fort Washington. Eventually, this would be the city of Cincinnati. But at the time, there was only a straggling little settlement there, and that's the fort. He built a fort there. He modestly named his fort at Marietta Fort Harmar, but this he named Fort Washington in Cincinnati. Now, maybe if he had the element of surprise in his favor, he might have had an advantage over the Shawnee and the Miami that he was about to face. He was going to march north from Fort Washington, pretty much due north up to Kikionga, where he knew the Miami capital was. The problem was he doomed the whole enterprise when he let Governor St. Clair of the Ohio Territory know what was going on, because what St. Clair did was he immediately sent a message to the British at Fort Detroit saying, by the way, we're going to lead an army up north to attack the Miamis and the Shawnees. Now, the Shawnees and the Miamis, of course, were the British allies. And now they knew that an American force was going north, so immediately the British told Little Turtle and Blue Jacket what was up. It was as if, before landing in Normandy, General Eisenhower had sent a message to Mussolini saying, by the way, we're going to be fighting the Germans in Normandy on June 6th. It's the same kind of thing. This trip makes no sense at all. But now St. Clair had alerted the British, and that meant that Little Turtle and Blue Jacket were also alerted. The British told the Indians, their Indian allies, that we'll pay you $50 for every American scalp you bring back to Fort Detroit. And now they were going to have plenty of time to get ready. So they marched north, Harmar's little army, maybe about 1,000 men, in September 1790, averaging about 10 miles a day, giving the Indians plenty of time to get ready. Now Little Turtle, who would be the overall commander of Shawnee, Miami, in their allied forces in this enterprise, wanted Harmar to march as far north as possible, away from his base at Fort Washington. So instead of defending every little village along the way, he allowed Harmar to proceed north without resistance. Many of the villages were burned by the Indians themselves. To encourage Harmar just to keep going and keep going 50, 60, 70 miles north of Fort Washington. Now when the army got to Kikionga, they found nobody there, and Harmar figured the war was won. All that remained, he felt, was to destroy as much as they could that retreating Indians had left behind them. So Harmar found 5 nearby villages. He burned them. They hadn't been burned by the Shawnees themselves. He found grain in the fields that he could burn. 20,000 bushels of grain were destroyed. And then, still in Kikionga, almost as an afterthought, he decided to send a few hundred men of the Kentucky militia a little bit further west across the border into what is now Indiana, just to see if they could find anything else they could destroy. Now that's exactly what Little Turtle had hoped would happen. As Colonel Hardin and the Kentuckians marched west from Kikionga towards the Wabash, every moment of the way, every step of the way, they were watched by scouts under Little Turtle's command. And finally, 16 miles away, the little force, Colonel Hardin's Kentuckians, emerged into a clearing, and all they had with them was just a handful of regular U.S. Army troops that Harmar had trained. But they got into this clearing along the Little Eel River, and at that point, the Shawnees and the Miamis and their allies struck, opening fire from 150 yards away. Almost all of the militia fled right away. But the 30 regulars, the 30 regular U.S. troops that were there, members of what Harmar called the 1st American Regiment, stood its ground. And in this, the first official battle of the official United States Army, 22 of those 30 were killed, standing their ground, overwhelmed by a charge of the Miamis and the Potawatomis, ordered by Little Turtle. Now, one of their officers, John Armstrong, although wounded, managed to crawl away and tell the tale, as did a few others. But of course, it was a desperate and complete victory by Little Turtle over that isolated Kentucky force. Now we can go 2 slides away from that. So at this point, having lost at Eel River, when Hardin arrived back at camp to tell the tale, he was one of the survivors, Harmar made probably the most popular decision he had made during the whole campaign. He said, let's go back to Fort Washington. Let's give up the whole thing. And so they're going to march south now, back to Fort Washington, having declared victory, despite what had just happened. So on October 19th, they left Kikionga behind them. And that might have been it, had not that same Kentuckian Colonel Hardin, feeling humiliated by what had happened on the Eel River, asked permission, when the army was south of Kikionga, to lead part of the army back north to Kikionga, just to see if any of the Shawnee or Miami had come back into the town. Maybe they could catch them unawares and actually win a victory. Harmar agreed. So off Hardin went with a few hundred regulars now, and also what was left of his Kentucky militia. And soon his entire column was strung out on the trail for miles and miles below Kikinyanga. He actually lost part of it. There were plenty of signs that he was now being observed again by Indians along the way. Hardin ignored those signs. And in fact, once more, they were walking into an ambush, this time not far from Kikinyanga on the banks of the shallow Maumee River. So his army was approaching here. This is the ford of the Maumee, and that's where they're going to cross. And as they approached the river, they could see right away, all of a sudden, sheets of musket fire from the Indians on the other side. Hardin's forces were just about decimated by those initial volleys. Horses and dying men choked the Maumee as Hardin tried to force that crossing. One Major Fontaine bravely ran up to the opposite bank, ran up to the ford in the teeth of very dense Indian fire, and shouted back to the others on the opposite bank, "Stick to me, men, follow me, stick to me." But only one man crossed to stick to him, and both were badly wounded. And then, at the height of this victory, looking as if everything was going their way, inexplicably to the US forces, Little Turtle ordered a retreat, which led Hardin to think he had won a great victory. All the appearances were to the contrary, but he thought, "I must have won, they're retreating." And you can see the path of the retreat going this way. So Hardin decided to cross the river in pursuit. Little Turtle in Blue Jacket had counted on exactly that. And they were waiting for them over here, just a couple miles away, at the end of a very large cornfield, where they would have a very nice sweeping field of fire as the Kentuckians and the regulars entered the cornfield. And sure enough, that's what happened. When Hardin's force entered the cornfield, they were set upon by very devastating Indian fire from a hazel thicket at the other end of the cornfield. After a few minutes of violent hand-to-hand combat, as US forces and Kentuckians desperately charged across to make contact with the Indians, finally, Major Fontaine was killed, and the rest of the force was very badly defeated. They fled precipitately back towards Harmar's camp, miles below Kikinyanga, leaving their dead and wounded on the field. Harmar's force had now been defeated in two decisive actions, one by the Maumee, one by the Eel River a few days before. It was obvious there was no way to try to go back to collect the wounded, the survivors, if there were any. There was now one choice, and that was to make their way back to Fort Washington as best they could. They arrived on November 3rd, the first campaign of United States troops against an assembled Indian Confederacy had ended in a humiliating failure for the United States. The disgraced Harmar resigned from the American service to his home in Philadelphia, which, rather unfortunately, he had named years earlier Harmar's Retreat. For the rest of his life, he would preach the virtues of Baron von Steuben's tactics to anybody, a dwindling few, who cared to listen. The Indians referred to the engagement on the Maumee up there by the hazel thicket, the Battle of the Pumpkin Fields, because the steam arising from the corpses on the battlefield reminded them of steamed squash in the autumn air. Now at this point, the obvious thing to do for President Washington in the administration was to spend some time training a first-class United States Army that could actually face Little Turtle in Blue Jacket on their own terms, deep in the Ohio country. They had to be trained in marksmanship. They had to be trained in light infantry tactics, had to have a good cavalry force. That would have been the thing to do. Spend a couple years training a very good, dependable, regular US Army force. But inexcusably, Washington and Secretary of War Knox continued to underestimate the strength, the will, and the talent of the Shawnees, the Miamis, and their allies. It was and is an old story, best encapsulated to me by a quote I found from an Englishman who was observing a disastrous Italian campaign in Ethiopia in 1896, when the Italians were totally defeated by an Ethiopian army that was defending their homeland. What explains the refusal to take seriously the strength of this Indian resistance. It is, this Englishman said in another context, contempt of a gallant enemy because his skin happens to be black or brown and because his men have not gone through an orthodox course in drill. So instead of putting in the hard work of actually putting a decent army together, Washington and Knox simply ordered Governor St. Clair of the Ohio Territory to raise another army and send them back in towards Kikianga. So now we'll go to the next slide. And now we meet the man who is now going to be in command. That's Governor St. Clair of Ohio, the Ohio Territory. He had a pretty good military mind. He had fought in the Revolution. Most people remember him because he had given up Ticonderoga to the British in 1777. But he probably had to do that. That was a terrible scar against his reputation. Maybe it wasn't such a bad idea that he was now in command. He had a pretty good military mind, but there was one big thing arguing against him. And if you read the pages of military history, often you will come across this particular word, gout. And you would say to yourself, why on earth are they sending somebody to command an army with gout? General St. Clair had gout. Nobody should ever command an army with gout. We know that gout is a buildup of uric acid in the joints, sometimes in the arms, very often in the feet, causing severe inflammation. But all they knew in the 18th century was, if you had gout, what that meant was excruciating pain. This was not kind of a fun disease that is associated with drinking a lot of port. So let's all have fun and eventually get gout. Gout is awful. Gout causes pain beyond description to people who suffer from gout. It's torture. It's unendurable. But there's no way to treat it back then in the 18th century except by laying back with your feet up, which is what General St. Clair would do. But how are you going to do that going on campaign 90 miles into Ohio country against a determined foe? He should never have taken this command, but he did. He thought it was his duty, and so he made his way down to Fort Washington, set about increasing that little force of American regulars, this time being paid $3 a month, not $7. So few wanted to join that they had to scour the jails of Kentucky and Pennsylvania to get enough regulars to actually man the force. Slowly, he began to gather the army together. This is going to be Pennsylvania militia and Kentucky militia. Nobody had much confidence in them, but they were going to join the force as well. Unfortunately, any possibility that gout-ridden, agonized St. Clair was going to meet with any success in this expedition was probably doomed by the fact that the person in charge of supplying the force was the infamous William Duer, D-U-E-R. And he took thousands of dollars in treasury money that was supposed to go to equip this little army at Fort Washington, and he spent it speculating on lands. He should have been put in jail right there, but he was a buddy with Secretary of War Knox because he'd loaned some money to Knox to buy his own lands. And so Duer, for the time being, got away with it. So by the time St. Clair was trying to raise this army, there was literally no ammunition at Fort Washington. They had to make it themselves at the growing little village of Cincinnati. There were no axes. There were no kettles. There were no canteens. All that had to be made in not very proper fashion by the soldiers themselves when they should have been training. And the shoes that Duer allowed the army to buy wore out literally in 1 week after they arrived. That's how bad they were. There were cannon. Most of them didn't work very well because they were cannon made for 3-pound shot and the army had 4-pound shot. Only a few cannon were actually going to do any job, but it probably didn't matter because the carriages, the wooden gun carriages on which the cannon rested, were no good and broke down right away. The only thing there was plenty of at Fort Washington in the summer of 1791, as St. Clair was supposed to be getting ready for this expedition, was whiskey. There was no shortage of whiskey, so much so that St. Clair finally marched the army 6 miles north of Fort Washington in the middle of nowhere, just so the whiskey wouldn't be around, just so maybe he could train them a little bit, although unfortunately not very much. And the whole time he's at Fort Washington, trying to get ready for what's looking increasingly like a hopeless expedition, a man named Tecumseh, every single day, was going into the American camp and looking around. And Tecumseh would eventually be the most famous of the Shawnee leaders. He was still a younger man then. He was in his 30s. So he'd go in the camp, he put on this big broad hat so nobody could see his features, and he'd just look around. He was a spy. And he'd go back, he'd send words to runners to get back to Little Turtle and Blue Jacket with all the news. So they knew everything that was going on while it was going on all through this period in the summer. Well, one of the guys that Tecumseh met, actually talked to, although he didn't know who he was a Bostonian, an officer in the Army named Winthrop Sargent. Great Boston name, Winthrop Sargent. Also a stockholder in the Ohio Company. So he's trying to protect his investment at the same time he's trying to defeat the Indian Confederacy. He was a Boston dandy, so he took with him on campaign a full dinner service made by Paul Revere. Just about everybody found him obnoxious beyond endurance. But my favorite officer in the Army, just because of what General Harmar told him, was a guy named Major Denny. I love this. So Major Denny went to see Harmar in Pennsylvania before he went out to join St. Clair. And this is what Harmar said to him. To me, maybe the worst words of encouragement ever given to somebody about to go into battle. This is what General Harmar said. Well, Major Denny, some of you may escape. Maybe you'll be one of them. It's not what you want to hear. So the Army was nowhere ready to go as of the late summer, early fall of 1791. But it's going to get cold pretty soon. So if they're going to go at all, it's got to be September. So the Army marched north late in September with St. Clair by now so racked with gout that he couldn't ride a horse, had to be dragged along in a litter, which was probably extraordinarily painful anyway for him. They were accompanying this little army, maybe about 1,700, 1,800 men. They were accompanied on the march by at least 100 women. Some of them were wives, some of them were laundresses, some of them were prostitutes. And along the way, they made an average march of 5 miles a day, 5 miles a day up north towards Kikianga. They built a fort about 40 miles north on the Great Miami River, paused there a little while. And then by mid to late October, about halfway to Kikianga, They built another one, which they called Fort Jefferson. Maybe they'd have a place to retreat to if something went wrong. But by this time, now it's getting to be mid to late October, weather's getting cold. And many of the militiamen, quite sensibly, decided to retreat. Desert. Rations, that's true. Retreat is what you're ordered to do. Desert is what you do on your own. And they were deserting. Rations were woefully low, but morale was lower. Nevertheless, St. Clair, as he marched north, who had no respect for his enemy, refused to send out scouts to see what the Shawnees, the Miamis, might be up to. He had really good scouts. They were Chickasaws from what is now Mississippi, master scouts. He wouldn't have them do anything. And the reason was he didn't like Indians, didn't think they were any good. And so the Chickasaws stayed with everybody else. Now, all in the afternoon of November 3rd, hungry and demoralized after suffering through a snowfall, they got to the Wabash River, what is now just across the border in Indiana. And there, late in the day, November 3rd, they made their camp. Now, inexcusably, St. Clair did not fortify that camp. Julius Caesar, during the Gallic Wars, would always fortify his camp. St. Clair apparently thought he was better than Julius Caesar. He didn't fortify his camp, even though General Washington had told him, always fortify your camp. Well, he didn't fortify the camp. And to make matters worse, he had sent some of his best troops south to check on the deserting militia and make sure they weren't stealing stores along the way, like at Fort Jefferson. Yes, go ahead.
What does that mean, fortify your
camp? Fortify the camp means you put up a sort of an embankment that you can fire behind, or at least you dig some sort of trench, put the cannon positions around, keep sentries out to make sure nobody's going to attack you. So one way or another, you're going to be ready for anything. Well, you didn't do any of that. They just pitched their tents as usual in this clearing on the Wabash. So the situation is, it's an unfortified camp. He's already sent part of his army back south, make sure the militiamen weren't stealing stuff who had deserted. And he's left with a remnant just waiting for an Indian attack that indeed was about to come. Now he had no idea, because he hadn't bothered using scouts, that he was surrounded by Shawnees and Miamis. A few American sentries had seen Indian movements in the woods. And they had told their immediate commander, General Butler, we think there's Shawnee in the woods, we think there's Miamis in the woods. General Butler, however, told them not to worry about it. He didn't even tell General St. Clair, and the reason was Butler hated General St. Clair and didn't want to be in communication with him. They weren't even on speaking terms. This is not good when you and your second command are not on speaking terms, especially when your second command has just been told we're about to be attacked. In fact, many of the Miami wanted to attack right away. It's the dusk, early evening, let's just go. Let's just attack, they don't know we're here. We got them surrounded. But Blue Jacket was now gonna be the main commander in this engagement. Blue Jacket insisted on waiting until just before dawn, only when everything was ready. He had a pretty good idea by now of what he was dealing with. He didn't think that force was gonna be ready in the morning any more than it was in the early evening, so there was plenty of time to wait. So that night, as the Indian Confederacy prepared their attack on the camp, unbeknownst to anybody in the camp, aside from those who could actually look into the woods, there was a council at which the Indian leaders gathered. In addressing the council was a man that all Americans knew back then. His name was Simon Girty. And Simon Girty was called by Americans the White Savage, quote, the White Savage, because he was indeed of European ancestry, and he'd acted as a liaison for a long time between the Shawnee and Miamis and the British, their British allies. He was actually a Pennsylvanian who had left at the age of 15 to join the Senecas along Lake Erie. And he won their respect very early on by running the gauntlet. So he runs this gauntlet of Senecas, they're beating him with sticks all the way. He went through very successfully without uttering a cry. And so he was adopted into the Senecas and lived with them for much of the rest of his life. After that, he temporarily allied with the Shawnee. He helped them defeat Daniel Boone at the Battle of Blue Licks in Kentucky in 1782. And by this point, he was generally despised by most Americans as a traitor. A few cared that during the Revolution, he had spent money from his own resources to ransom American captives from British and Indian allies. But that night, just before the battle, Girty, who's on the British side, who's helping the Indians, Girty stood up in front of the assembled leaders and had an egg in his right hand, and he said, "The egg are American forces, my fingers are the Indians, and this is what's going to happen," and he'd destroy the egg right there, crush it with his fist, letting the yolk go all the way down his arm. Then, in the first glimmers of the sunrise, now we can go to the next slide. The first glimmers of the sunrise, as militiamen began to brew their coffee, the Shawnees on the banks of the Wabash, the Shawnees, Miamis, Sauk, Kickapoos, and Winnebagoes began yelling, which woke up and terrified the militia forces and the regulars in camp. Some of them ran away at the sound. The rest did so, many of the rest did so, as the Indians began firing at the personal direction of both Little Turtle and Blue Jacket. Although, as I said, it appears that at this battle, Blue Jacket exercised the most authority. Hundreds of the US forces dashed in the direction of the Wabash, believing there might be safety across the shallow river. If they paused at all, it was only to loot the tents of their officers on the way. St. Clair tried to stop them, but he could not get on his horse. To his credit, despite his terrible, agonizing pain, he limped as fast as he could go, shouting, "Stop, organize, rally, cowards, cowards, cowards," to very little avail. He managed to get six of the cannon that could fire, he managed to get them firing, but it did no good because the Indians had learned that one of the best things you can do in attacking a U.S. force was to pick off the artillerymen first. And whenever anybody tried to fire a cannon, they were picked off by Shawnee or Miami marksmen. The Indians were now firing from all sides of the camp. And a few days before this engagement, St. Clair had told one of his junior officers, "Don't worry about the Indians. Quote, if attacked," St. Clair said, "the savages will always break. They are too undisciplined to stand up to an attack." Well, this undisciplined, here's what happened next. Desperately, a bayonet charge was organized to try to at least drive off Indians from some point of the encampment. And the bayonet charge seemed to work. Some of the Miami seemed to give way. But the reason they gave way was so that the bayonet charge, those who were launching the charge, would be led forward only to meet with flanking fire from Indians who were there for that very purpose. Those who had retreated just went in either direction to form flanking fire and very, very badly hurt the attacking force. So that's a very disciplined force, as St. Clair now found out to his sorrow. The ground by 7:30 a.m. was littered with American dead. By 8 a.m., Indians were within the main camp, meaning only with disorganized opposition. Females by now firing alongside with the desperate men. St. Clair's second-in-command, General Butler, desperately tried to salvage the situation, showing a great deal of courage. He was shot twice, fearing that he would collapse He had himself propped against a tree, where he continued to fire with his pistol, hoping his men would rally around him. The night before, after ignoring those sentry reports I told you about, Butler had laughingly said, "Let us eat, drink, and be merry tonight, for tomorrow we may die." And ultimately he did. His skull was crushed by a tomahawk, and the Shawnee so respected his courage that some of them devoured his heart after the battle. He had fought so bravely and so well. Well, there was only one thing to do, and that was to retreat any way this army could. Delay was death, as one officer said. There was no alternative. So at 9 a.m., just a few hours after the battle began, St. Clair, by now painfully mounted on a pack horse, directed the survivors to break out as best they could. And he felt the best way to go was to the south, so he organized another bayonet charge. Down to the south they charged. They left their cannon behind. They left their baggage behind. They left a lot of their wounded behind in their haste to get out any way they could. For reasons we don't quite understand, Little Turtle and Blue Jacket let them go. Probably could have destroyed the entire force. It may be that they didn't think there were enough Americans to worry about after this. Why not let them go? It may be that they didn't want to kill anybody. They thought that might be a rallying cry for a future retribution. But whatever the reason was, some of the American force managed to get out. There had been 1,400 Americans in the camp. Over half of them had been killed. Almost all of those who had broken out were wounded in some way. Maybe about 100 of the 1,400 were not wounded. In terms of percentage of casualties, dead and wounded, this, the Battle of the Wabash, was not only the worst defeat ever inflicted by indigenous peoples on a United States force, it was probably the worst defeat ever inflicted on a major body of the United States Army in its history. Casualties were well over 50%. Dead and wounded. Indian casualties amounted to 21 dead and 40 wounded. All St. Clair could do was collect what few regulars he had, who he had sent them back to guard that supply train, remember, in with the defeated remnants of his force, limp back to Cincinnati. He resigned from the Army at Washington's request, although Knox wrote him a nice letter saying that it couldn't be helped, nobody could have done better, which was silly. Of course somebody could have done better. Anybody who had recognized the talent and the skill of this Indian Confederacy probably would have done better. St. Clair insisted there was nothing to do for it, I was outnumbered. The Indians were outnumbered at this battle. Probably the number of warriors that Little Turtle and Blue Jacket commanded were about 1,000 at the Wabash, and the Americans had 1,400. A lot of the blame went to William Dwyer, where it belonged. He was the one who was supposed to be supplying the force. He'd eventually die in prison after being caught in numerous financial frauds. But the real problem, of course, was that nobody in authority properly appreciated how formidable this Confederacy was. The Battle of the Wabash, by the way, while we're on the topic, was also significant because a lot of people back in the new United States government were very upset by it, including members of Congress. So for the first time in our history, the House of Representatives decided to exercise the oversight powers that they have under the Constitution. So we know that the House and the Senate can investigate what happens in the executive branch. That's the oversight power. And this is the first time Congress used the oversight power. So they had St. Clair in to testify. They had the officers in there testify. What went wrong? What can we do better? And oversight would have a very long history through Watergate and through our present day. And this is the first time. And they asked Washington, the House did, can you give us all the documents regarding what St. Clair was all about? And Washington had a big cabinet meeting. Do I have to give them the documents? Do I have to give the House the documents? And Jefferson said, yeah, probably. And so Washington did. And so that's the beginning of oversight. These two victories, a Harmar's defeat on the Maumee, and now St. Clair's even worse defeat on the Wabash, showed Americans at long last that there was no easy way to overcome indigenous resistance in the Ohio country. And they also showed, by the way, a recipe for Indian success in the wars to come. So if these conditions were met, maybe the traditional indigenous peoples of the West could actually do something about what everybody knew was the prospect of encroaching permanent European and African settlement to the West. Here's the recipe for victory. They need to cooperate with one another. So here in the Ohio country, we had a confederation. It wasn't just the Shawnees, Miamis, Kickapoos, Wyandots, Foxes, Sox, and Potawatomis as well. So if they can cooperate, that's one recipe for perhaps enduring success. Another one was they need allies. So they need the British. They need the British for weapons. They need the British for logistic support and to repair weapons, to make sure that a musket that wasn't working would work in the future. So they needed British support. They needed a Confederacy. They needed leaders of genius, which they had in the Ohio country. Little Turtle and Blue Jacket were tacticians and strategists of a very high order. So great leadership, British support, Confederacy, you put all three together and you've got a chance to resist encroaching American settlement. The fourth ingredient would have to be United States stupidity, which they certainly had in the Ohio country. You put all four together, maybe you've got a chance as the Indians of the West. Unfortunately, two of those crucial ingredients would be lacking in the next campaign. So Washington decided to launch a third campaign into the Ohio country, but this time, to his credit, he decided that there was no sense in sending another slipshod, hastily organized force to face the Shawnees and the Miamis. Instead, he decided to name a leader of genuine genius to lead the new force, and that would be General Anthony Wayne. And he insisted on spending over a year actually training an army. So now we'll go to the next slide.
Mad Anthony Wayne.
So that's unfortunately for the Shawnees is what was about to happen. So Wayne, rather than simply gather a few militiamen and give a little bit of drill to a few regulars, actually raised an army and trained it for what they would need to know in the Ohio country. They could march quickly, they could march light. He had a cavalry force that was very good. And after over a year of training, as Harmer had done, as St. Clair had done, he marched them north from Fort Washington. Everywhere he went, Wayne's army burned Indian crops in the ground, a tried and true tactic meant to quell long-term Indian resistance. And in August of 1794, he would attack Little Turtle's and Blue Jacket's forces along the Maumee, close to modern Toledo, at a place where a recent tornado had blown down a bunch of trees, hence the name of the Battle of Fallen Timbers, in 1794. So August of 1794, the battle took place. Wayne, here you see his cavalry mounting a flank attack, which was the key point of the battle. At this battle, Wayne won a decisive victory. The war might have gone on anyway, except that as the Shawnees and Miamis were retreating, they hoped to find a British garrison supporting them at Fort Miami, which is now Toledo, but the British closed their doors. They didn't want any further trouble with the young United States government, and so they would not let Indians in. They would not give them further support after the battle was lost at Fallen Timbers. So now two of those ingredients for victory are gone. The Americans have good leadership and the British are withdrawing support, at least for the time being, at least for the time being. And so that meant that Little Turtle and Blue Jacket both arrived at the same conclusion that they had to make some sort of a deal. And so the next year, in 1795, they signed what would become the Treaty of Greenville. So we can turn to the next slide and see what's going on here. By the Treaty of Greenville, the Shawnees and Miamis and their allies agreed to give up claims to all of this south of this line in the Ohio country. This is the Scioto Valley here. There's the Ohio, of course. This is Muskingum. And they reserved this area up here by their old capital at the portage between the Maumee and the Wabash. So they preserved this territory for the time being, but they had to give up all claims to everything else. So that was the Treaty of Greenville in 1795. I think we have another slide about it. Go to the next one. This is a painting of the Treaty of Greenville. If you go to the Ohio State Capitol in Columbus, you can see this painting. The artist is Howard Christie, who you can also see his stuff if you go to the Café d'Artiste in Manhattan. But this is Christie's rendition of the Treaty of Greenville. And that's Little Turtle there, and that's Blue Jacket there. And that's General Wayne there. One of the most decisive of all treaties ever signed by indigenous peoples, the remnant of the land of the Shawnees and Miamis that were kept after the Treaty of Greenville would be finally lost to them after the events of Tippecanoe in the War of 1812. But for the time being, they hang on to that territory at least. And ultimately, oh, by the way, Tecumseh would die in battle. He'd die at the hands of U.S. forces, the Battle of the, I think what they call it, the Thames, in 1813 in the War of 1812. But he would lead for the resistance for the time being, a military leader that, if anything, was even greater than Little Turtle and Blue Jacket. And we wish we could talk more about him, but we have to go on to the Seminole War next time. But ultimately, both the Miami and the Shawnee were forced to move west. after the War of 1812, where to this day their descendants live in the state of Oklahoma. As for the Ohio Company of Associates, they eventually divided all their shares among various stockholders who would sell land on their own, so they ceased to exist almost as soon as the Treaty of Greenville was signed in 1795. Finally, if you look over here, go to the slide before that. After the Treaty of Greenville, that gave a lot of encouragement to a Connecticut guy named Moses Cleveland. And so he moved his people out there to the Western Reserve and formed the city of Cleveland. So that's that for our first installment in the story of the long twilight struggle of indigenous peoples against United States settlement. Okay, thank you.
Just a couple housekeeping things. I want to thank the Friends of the Library for sponsoring this lecture and all the programs they sponsor for us for their hard work. None of this could happen without them. And I also want to thank the volunteers who provide us the goodies here that are at the table. So thank you very much for that.